Now we are officially on the record here. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Eli Saltzman. I'm a professor and the director of the Gildenhorn Institute for Israel Studies at the University of Maryland. This is our second webinar dedicated to the exploration of various aspects of the Israel-Hamas war. If you have any questions or comments, please use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. Please keep your comments short and your questions even shorter so the speakers have enough time to address as many of those during the Q&A section of the webinar. Don't forget, a question is a sentence with a question mark. Today's online event is entitled The Media and the Israel-Hamas War, and it aims to examine the role of the media in shaping public perceptions and understandings of the Israel-Hamas conflict, with a specific focus on international and Israeli media. The two speakers will explore the nuances of coverage, including biases, framing, and the challenges of reporting from conflict zones to show how different narratives emerge and evolve, influencing both global perspectives on the complex geopolitical realities at play. Special attention will be given to the ethical considerations involved in reporting on conflicts, the use of digital media and social media, and the impact of media narratives on politics, public opinion, and international responses. Before introducing our esteemed speakers today, I would like to plug in a few of the other events we're organizing this semester, which are designed to address different perspectives of the ongoing conflict in the Middle East. The first one is a webinar entitled Teaching About Israel in Time of Conflict, featuring a number of speakers. This will take place on March 28, 6 p.m. Eastern. Another event is a special Gildenhorn Institute event, The World Crisis, American Leadership, and the Israel-Gaza War, featuring Representative Jamie Raskin. That is April 8th at 6 p.m. Eastern. This is in person on campus. And we have another in-person event on May 2nd, Ilan Zvi Baron from Durham University. The title is Contested Cuisines, Food, and the Israeli-Palestinian Conflict. For more information and to register, please visit our website, www.israelstudies.umd.edu. As promised, it is an honor and a pleasure to introduce today's first speaker, Anat Balint. I'll introduce Marwa Maziad a couple of minutes later, a few minutes later. Dr. Anat Balint is the Jeffrey B. Plevin Chair in Israel Studies at the University of Arizona. Before arriving in Arizona, she was an Israel Institute visiting scholar and coordinator of the Jewish Studies program at San Jose University. San Jose State University, my apologies. Dr. Balint is a media scholar who specializes in the political economy of the media and the politics of Israeli media. But she's not only an academic observer, she's also a practitioner or an ex-practitioner. She was a journalist for Haaretz for many years and an adjunct lecturer in the Department of Communications at Tel Aviv University. She's written extensively on the inner workings of Israeli media and politics. She's an activist for media ethics and freedom of the press in Israel and a frequent commentator on these issues. Anat Balint, go ahead, my friend. The floor is yours. I will mute myself so you
All
can.
right, no, I like conversations actually. It's okay. All right, hi everyone. It's wonderful to be here, and thank you, Eli, for inviting me. And hello, Dr. Maziad, Marwa Maziad, and I'm looking forward to hear what you have to say on the international arena as you speak right after me. So, as Eli mentioned, I'm a former Israeli journalist, and I've been writing about Israeli media for many years. And now I'm looking at the Israeli media really at a distance because I'm in Arizona. So I have to say that before we start talking about what's happening in Israel, I'm following it very closely, but outside of Israel. And as such, I feel I miss some of the experience of being in Israel because the experience is of saturation. Of being surrounded by media, news media, ongoing reports, probably less now than it was in the first few weeks. But I want you to first, before we even start talking about it, experience this sense of being within a media bubble of first, it's all in Hebrew, and it relates to the local Israeli situation and news. There's intense reporting all the time and conversations, and so there's a lot of relating to the situation, which is of course natural. After saying that, I would say another important point, which I think is also important when we'll talk about the international media. There is no foreign media on the ground now in Gaza. When I say foreign media, there's no Israeli media on the ground in Gaza, unless they come with an army at times for short kind of tours. There are no Western foreign reporters, and the media really relies first and foremost on what we call stringers, locals who provide professional amateurs or even everyone, right? I mean, that's part of the privileges of our time, that everyone can provide media and reflection of what's going on. So this is, of course, wonderful that everyone can send out media, but my point is that there are no outsiders in Gaza looking at the situation, reporting it, all right? And we need to take that into consideration when we think of the reporting from Gaza. Really, it's only reported by the subjects themselves, those who are part of the suffering of the war. This is another reason why really it is hard to estimate accurately the number of casualties, the destruction, although it's evident and there are a lot of reporting coming out. So we have here a scene of kind of this closed Israeli bubble in Hebrew with no live on the ground reporting from Gaza. People who are in total trauma, not just those directly affected, but basically everyone in Israel share their experience of being post-traumatic and very hardly hit by the massacre of October 7th. And this is the ground on which I would say blindness, lack of information, nationalism, followed by racism can thrive. So the Israeli media, and again, I don't like to talk usually about media as such, because really there's no such thing. When you talk about media, you always talk about multiple voices and different outlets and so forth. But after saying that, I will say that at large, it is totally okay and acceptable to report the situation only from an Israeli point of view, right? It's always been the case, and now even more to an extreme, it is okay to look at the world from this narrow though understandable angle of the Israeli situation, the Israeli fear and trauma, the Israeli interests, the Israeli needs, and overlook almost everything else. The facts are there. So Israelis are aware of the bombings and the hunger in Gaza and the number of people who died and so forth. What I think mainly is lacking is not so much the facts, but another thing that, and now I'm talking about mainstream media, does, which is bring the human story, which is basically the side of empathy, right? Conveying empathy to the Palestinian suffering in mainstream media in Israel now, I would say that gently is, I wouldn't say it gently, it's not a place you want to go, all right? The tolerance, the space to contain the suffering and the pain of others evaporated. It's not there. To the extent that if anyone takes a stand that is really talking about the human toll, the suffering, questions about the war, very quickly they would be tagged as almost traitors, right? Not from us, not on the side of Israel, because everything is so divided, so black and white, right? There could not be a situation, as the narrative is presented in Israeli media, of both Israeli and Palestinian suffering, right? This kind of simultaneous horror or suffering is not something that can be tolerated now in Israel. I'm trying to describe it. I'm not justifying it. I'm actually criticizing it. And I would say even more, or not even more, but I will try to explain. Most of the media in Israel is commercial media, as is the case in the United States. And here we see that kind of interaction between the economic model, the money-making of media outlets, and nationalism. Because news outlets, media outlets, are aware of their role and obligation to report the news, to give the whole picture, to provide information, and so forth, and it's there. But on the other hand, they do not want to annoy their audience. Not only they do not want to annoy their audience at this very difficult time, to challenge in any way, right, their perspective, they're actually working to satisfy their audience. They're not just providing information because of their economic model of maximizing audience, of trying to get the more people together to watch or to consume on online or so forth. They would look very much to satisfy their audiences, right? What do Israelis need now? Do they need reports on families that lost 20 people, children included, in this war? Or would it make people so angry that they would refuse to watch the news here ever again, right? So the fear of making your audience angry, and even more of that, the search of satisfying audiences, right, bring or creates this bias. And I'm not saying here anything new, right? It exists all the time, but in this time of crisis and war, it all becomes more extreme. Media outlets, generally speaking, are working to satisfy the emotional needs of the audience, although they're pretending they're just reporting the facts, right? And maybe it's even worse, right? We're just here to report the news. Actually, by avoiding or overlooking some things and not bringing the story of the other side fully, as you do with the Israeli side, well, you're actually working to serve the emotional needs of Israelis today. So this is something, and if, you know, if people will have questions about this later, what I described is the bias of commercial media, right? It exists always. It exists in the United States, you know, in other countries. It's part of the nature of commercial media. But in times when information is so crucial, when it is even more important to provoke your audience, to impose, if you like, information on them, the mechanisms of commercial media become more dangerous and influential as they allow the maintenance of war without understanding or overlooking its impact on the other side, right? It allows this blindness or ignorance of choice. And so, you know, this nurtures more violence, in my opinion, not less. So where is the kind of, you know, I spoke about mainstream media as where facts are reported that really actually serve emotional needs. But where do the emotions are out in the open? Well, on social media, right? Social media is the place where you don't really report the facts. It's not journalism. It's whatever you want, right? You can do whatever you want on social media. And you can very openly in an uncensored way express the undercurrents, right? All those emotions, and there are a lot of emotions now in Israel. And I'm not just looking at it from a distance. I'm part of it. You know, I have the trauma, I have the anger, I have the hatred, you know, I have all of this. I have to say, all of these emotions were part of what I experienced. And I have all these voices in my mind saying, you know, but you have to remember, and you need to try to understand, and you cannot give in just to fear and anger and hatred and all of this, right? So, and I don't think that there's one Israeli that didn't experience this kind of storm and traumatic experience of feeling all these things all at once. What we see during this war, or what at least I see, is how many presentations of nationalism, of hatred, of violence, of racism are not only much more common, but they became much more understandable, much more normative, right? And this is something that you'll see on social media. So it is about talking about how we're united and how we're together. Fine, that's understandable. How we're going to overcome this, how we're going to win the war, how we're going to crush the other side, how the other side are inhumane, brutal, barbaric, monkeys, baboons, okay? And if you see, I'm quoting all this, right? And I'm going from like the more moderate expressions to clear expressions of violence, dehumanization of the other side, and of course, not looking at the suffering of the other side, seeing the other side as just one thing, an enemy, an entity, right? It reminds me of people talking about the Zionist entity, right? That's also kind of trying to dehumanize the other side. As one entity that deserves nothing but death. And would you always find some kind of in the margins of societies, people talking like that? You would, right? But what happened, and social media is crucial in helping this emerge, is that this conversation became much more common and acceptable. It's not only just the lunatics from the, you know, fanatic margins of the right that would talk like that, but now everyone understands this kind of emotions. And, you know, I'm looking at a lot of recipe videos, kind of cooking videos on, I mean, all of us, I don't know. I'm like, it comes up and I kind of sometimes spend my time looking at all kinds of people cooking on TikTok and Instagram and, you know, and Facebook and so forth. There are wonderful Israeli chefs and amateurs that are doing wonderful things. But then since October 7th, you know, some of them, not all of them, some of them would say, all right, so you take this and you grind this as we're going to grind Gaza, and then you throw it in as we're going to throw Hamas and so forth. And this is entertainment, right? And this is as by the way. Let me share with you just a few examples of some social media celebs or influencers that are kind of on the rise and are doing sometimes funny things. They're coming from certain groups in Israeli society, right? So they don't represent necessarily all Israelis, I would say, and I want to emphasize it. But just to kind of show you kind of the banality of nationalist conversation, of a militant conversation, and how Israelis are really kind of very much into their own situation and not looking at the other side. So let me show you. I'll just share a screen. Sorry. Let me just get to the right thing that I want to show you first. We'll see a number of things. The first one is from an example from a guy called you're all seeing it. I hope you are. Eli, are we good with the screen?
Yep.
Oh, let me just do the sound share. Sorry. Share sound. Okay, we're good. This is a guy who comes from a religious background. He's a teacher in the yeshiva. He was educated in the occupied territories in a settlement some years of his life. So we know where he's coming from politically. He's very talented. He for years tried to break out with, you know, as a singer and doing stand-up comedy and so forth. And since the war, he's on the rise, right? He's thriving. This is in Hebrew, but it'll get to an English part and I'll try to explain some of it. Needs to start from the beginning.
אשתו גם עם כל העולם, יהיה בקש עוד הזדמנות, עשינו טעות.
All right, as you can see, he posted so many things. I'm just now going to risk it and I'm going to show
you.
Stay here as long as it takes. All right, this is a very, very a short example.
And it's too soon.
All right, this is a clip titled After Another Killing of a Terrorist, okay? This is how they look.
Push the fucking pack off of the porch or break a pound down. Get the scrap if it happen to blow, it makes a round sounds. Pussy cat on my lap, push it back and go to town now. Putting rap on my back and I'm black and stacking crown.
I'll stop share and just give some context. This guy is on a reserve duty, right? And so we see for the first time this phenomenon of soldiers in uniform, as they are serving basically part of a war, also posting on social media in uncensored way. And you ask yourself, do they represent the army? Do they not represent the army, right? Can the army even control this kind of things? And what it shows here is how they're celebrating the killing of another terrorist. And you can say, well, this is totally understandable. These are terrorists and they are there to fight. And they're working to kind of have their kind of morale and motivation, you know, up. This is also horrifying, right? Since when do we see Israeli soldiers kind of celebrating blood, right? Does that represent me? I want to say no, right? There are so many ethical questions that are coming up here. And let me show you another clip by the same guy. All right, let's go and do this one. I'll just share again.
Oh, we good person. We gave tzedakah. We help them with electric water. They come to us and attack us. They more than crazy. We are good. They know. Bad. Evil. Yeah. So you need support. Gaga.YouTube. We didn't did anything. Yes. No. Family. Yes. Israel under attack. They're the good. Support us. Give us weapon. We are strong. Just for the Todah. And my say yes. Like. Subscribe. Share. Israel.
Yes. Okay. I'll show you at the beginning again. He is he's saying, so he's a comedian, right? He's trying to be funny and saying, now I'll represent the Israeli position in the world because people don't understand this, and look at me how I'm doing it.
Kisses, duty free.
All right, my friends, I'm joining the propaganda efforts. Please share this clip so it will get to the whole world. And then it starts.
Dear world, they attack us before. We are good, Israel is good, Hamas is bad. We didn't start it. They started with us. They attack us, the Grindmeiser Hamas. Yes? We didn't. No, we good person. We gave tzedakah. We help them with electric water. They come to us and attack us. They murder crazy. We are good. They know. Bad. Evil. Yes? So you need support. Gaga.YouTube. We didn't did anything. Yes? No? Family? Yes, Israel under attack. They're the good. Support us. Give us weapon. We are strong. Just for the Todah. And my say yes. Like, subscribe, share. Well, yes. Kisses. Duty free.
All right. So this is, of course, to some extent funny because he also mocks Israelis, how they, you know, kind of how he really doesn't speak English well. I'm sure his English is much better than this one. How they're very kind of clumsy in explaining their position. But it also portrays kind of the Israeli mood and how Israelis think, right? We're good, they're bad, they're evil. You need to support us. You need to be on our side. So here is it's a mix of entertainment and some horrible things that he says in his clips. Like he titles all these clips "As a Booby," which means "As a Honey," as if we're coming to get you. It's a very threatening, actually, kind of sweet talk. He calls the Palestinians in Gaza that are all Hamas for him monkeys. We're gonna get you. We're gonna bomb you, and so forth. I'll show yet another example of something from social media to show again a little bit how this very nationalist conversation became totally acceptable. This is very short, and I'm sure it comes across in English as well. All right, it will start in a second.
Hayo haya pam Hamas. Hasof.
So this is a guy who says, this is how I sound like when I read a bedtime story. He opens the book, he says, once upon a time, there was Hamas. The end. Thank you. Again, and he's wearing uniform. He's representing basically the IDF, if he wears uniform. And he's really saying, in a sweet, funny talk, we're gonna kill you. We're gonna eliminate you, right? And I think these are all kind of borderline examples of things that you say, well, in a time of war, a country that it was so badly hit and devastated, you can understand this kind of humor. And on the other side, it raises, I think, grave ethical questions as to what became very legitimate, right, of soldiers in uniform talking about their passion for killing, for getting back at the enemy, of not differentiating between Palestinians, civilians and Hamas, and really kind of encouraging this kind of bloodthirst mode. I think I'll stop here because Eli, tell me if I took too much of the time. And maybe this would be a start of some thought and answering questions.
Excellent. So this is actually right on time. All righty. Thank you so much.
Every day.
Absolutely. You're punctual. Let me present our next speaker, Dr. Marwa Maziad. Dr. Marwa Maziad is a visiting lecturer of Israel Studies at the University of Maryland, a former non-resident fellow with the Middle East Institute's Defense and Security Program, and a senior faculty at American University Center for Israel Studies in Washington, D.C. Dr. Maziad specializes in comparative civil-military relations with a focus on the United States, Egypt, and Israel, Turkey, and the Gulf states. She held academic faculty positions at Qatar University and Northwestern University in Qatar and published extensively on Middle East security affairs. And I'm not so sure if she has journalism in her past, but she's very active in the media as well. Dr. Maziad, the floor is yours, my friend.
Hi, Eli. Thank you for having me here, and nice to meet you, Anat. And very stimulating points. I think I will respond maybe to some of the things you mentioned and kind of paint an international perspective on all of this. Yes, I have a journalism background. I was trained as a journalist in my undergraduate, and I was a columnist for newspapers, and I'm a regular on BBC Arabic and also I24 News and other outlets. I think it's important to maybe contextualize a little bit the narrative that emerged internationally. And by international, I follow the French press, the US, of course, the Arabic media, Turkish. I speak all these languages, so I get my news from all of these outlets. And it's interesting to see the development of the narrative. I think it took 2 weeks from October 7th to October 15th or so, or 18th or so, to have a clear narrative internationally that Israel was attacked. It's a surprise attack. It's a strategic failure in intelligence, in defense, in security, in political imagination of even where Hamas stands, where Gaza stands, as the current Israeli government has kind of created a wedge between Hamas and Gaza on one side and the West Bank on the other side, in preparation for annexation of the West Bank, but kind of thinking that Gaza is like safe and can be separated from the two. So this is all strategic failures that led to the surprise attack, and the world more or less was interested in one word, which is Israel's right to defend itself and respond to this attack. That took about 2 weeks. From mid-October until now, like 5 months later, I think the narrative shifted very much internationally and within the region, which matters, I think, even more than just international media. I think regional dynamics in other countries, especially in neighboring Egypt, Jordan, Qatar, UAE, all the countries that either have formal peace treaties or agreements with Israel or have relations that are ongoing, playing a role, like Qatar playing a role in the negotiations, etc., regarding the hostages. These countries and their populations matter a whole lot, matter more than, I would say, matter more than distant international audiences or even the US for that matter. And that's because in the end, Israel's integration in the region or lack thereof or undoing of a lot of what has been happening over maybe decades of potential acceptance and integration, tolerance, etc., matters to these populations and matter to their leadership. So I think the narrative shifted after 2 weeks because of the notion of whether what's Israel's response is proportionate or disproportionate, whether it is a collective punishment. We hear these words, so I'm going to even enumerate words that you hear from the leadership in Egypt, in Jordan, and those, as I say, countries that already have treaties and formal relations with Israel. So these are partners. But when accusation of collective punishment, what is the plan? What's the military plan? Like when military leaders from other countries look and say, what is your plan of moving all the Palestinians from the north to the middle and then to Rafah? That's early, early. We're talking mid-October, late October. So this idea of suspicion about the strategy, about the goals, about the how this war is to be conducted, started being one of the main stories in the international media. And I would say that even though, just in response to what Anat said about the reporters on the ground, they are Palestinians, but Al Jazeera, it's an international news outlet, and it always, during the Gaza specifically, Gaza wars prior, it always said, you know, or at least part of its narrative is that the bombs come from the sky and we report where they land. So being embedded or on that side, other than, you know, and working for international news, or like how BBC covers this, and how even CNN for some time they were able to enter and then come out. I think then the stories, the visuals became dominant by the mid to end of October. And I think the dominance of the images that came from Gaza of the Palestinians like haunted populations worldwide, haunted the Arab population and Muslim population in particular. And I think in response, you know, in almost in juxtaposition to what Anat is describing regarding the Israelis within Israel, it seems really like as if the Israelis are seeing one thing in a bubble, also the nationalistic sentiments, all of that she described, and as if the rest of the region, like the Arab world, the neighbors around, and the rest of the world see a completely different picture, and each one for themselves kind of try to reconcile these two. So I think the timeline is important. 2 weeks of almost complete support, and then followed by almost 5 months of interrogation, questioning, what is it genocide, the ICJ, famine, dehydration, the number of killed, 31,000 Palestinians, 12,800 children. CNN just reported a report that was maybe, some are like looking at it as the first very detailed report about stories of Palestinian children with their names, and even they did the studio around them with 12,800 dots all over, you know, the image, the screens. So this is kind of a shift in the way the Palestinians are narrated, and I think that emphasizes this kind of difference from how this war is perceived from within Israel as opposed to within the region, and that matters a whole lot. And the rest of the world as we come to the United States. That's one thing. The other thing I wanted to say is this narrative of success and failure of the strategy has been maybe there really early on. What I want to share is one short video of an interview with Noy Katzman, who is the sibling of Chaim Katzman, who was killed in Kibbutz Cholit. He's a dear friend of mine from University of Washington, and that was very personal to me, that I lose someone on October 7th. But Noy was interviewed by CNN, and he had something to say at the very end that I wanted to share with you, because I think that was significant to say that October 9th or 10th. So let's just listen to this.
We are learning more and more each day of such horrific and traumatic stories of those who were either kidnapped or killed by terrorists of Hamas on Saturday. I want to show you now one of the victims killed in this clear act of terrorism. His name was Chaim Katzman. He was 32. He was a peace activist. His neighbor told CNN that Chaim was shot to death as he hid in a closet. Here's how she described this man who was murdered in cold blood.
He was a wonderful person. He was a talented person. He was a funny person. He was someone who wanted to live. His name is Chaim. Chaim in Hebrew is life. That's the meaning of his name. And he gave life to this planet because he saved me. And I was able to save two kids. He was a good friend. He was a good soul in this world.
Noi Katzman joins me now. Chaim was their brother. Noi, I'm very, very sorry for your loss. Chaim's neighbor describes him as a wonderful person. What do you want people to know about Chaim?
Okay, so Chaim was, as I said, so he used to, he was, first of all, he was a brilliant academic. He was a brilliant academic in Israel studies. He wrote about religious Zionism and about the risks and the danger of right-wing uprising in Israel.
Yeah, it's my understanding he cared a lot about the Palestinian people, He opposed the Netanyahu government, and he was trying to work to bring rights to the human rights to the Palestinian people.
Definitely. He was an activist in Misafariata, where the IDF is doing, and Israel are doing cleansing of the Palestinians, of the native Palestinians who live there. He was a very active there. I'm also part of that community, and they wrote to me how he was active there. He also volunteered in Rahat, which is a Bedouin city, which sadly doesn't have enough shelters now, and a lot of people from there are killed. And he also was active in Watch, Chsom Watch, which watching the occupation, and also in Academy for Equality, which is...
How was he as a sibling?
My family. And they are, it's like difficult. We're six siblings, and not easy for us.
Noi Katzman, may Chaim's memory be a blessing. I'm so sorry for your loss.
Can I say one more thing?
Yeah. Thank you so much.
What I wanted to say is the most important for me, and I think also for my brother, was that his death won't be used to kill innocent people. And sadly, my government is using cynically the death of people to just kill. Like, they promised us it's gonna bring us security, but of course it's not security, because they always tell us, oh, that if we're going to kill enough Palestinians, or they're going to, so it's going to be better for us. But of course it never brings us peace, and it never brings us better lives. It just brings more and more terror and more people killed, like my brother. And I don't want anything to happen to people in Gaza like it happens to my brother. And I'm sure he wouldn't have any either. So that's my call to my government: stop killing innocent people. And that's not the way that brings us peace and security to people in Israel.
Noi Katzman, thank you so much. And may your brothers, may Chaim's memory be a blessing.
So, yeah, I wanted to share this because I think it was a significant voice early on of someone who's... sibling was killed in this attack, but to say that that should not be what he anticipated Gaza to look like. And that's, as I said, very early in late October. And I think in the end, I mean, now, you know, examining how the narrative has evolved should be analyzed in order to see whether the stated goals, the stated strategic goals by Israel are being achieved or not. Eliminating Hamas 5 months later, that didn't happen, and I don't think it will happen. There are arguments about if you eliminate them, there will be 10,000 replacing them. Releasing the hostages. Well, we were talking back in October about really the release of the hostage, and by November, when that respite, like 1 week of releasing about 100 of the hostages, and really that kind of the world caught its breath a little bit, and then that was undone and was never resumed. I think that also was a significant step towards that goal, and now that goal is not achieved. In fact, more of the hostages are being killed in the process of this war. And then this idea of fighting some civilizational war between Axis of Evil and Iran and all of, so that brings us back maybe to the 2003 moment when it was all about Iraq, Iran, North Korea, the Axis of Evil, and Netanyahu's character was trying to think of, like, as we go to Iraq, maybe there is Iran. And I don't think the world was ready then to have a repeat of Iraq, or ready now to have a repeat of Iraq that would drag the United States in it either. So it's important to see how the narrative shifted over the past 5 months, internationally and regionally, in contrast to what seems like an isolated or separated Israeli polity that maybe is, whose government at least seems out of touch with the perceptions around the world. And I think it's very important, if we are to advise the Israelis, is to be cognizant of how the medium term and longer term effect of this war on Israel's integration in the region and its own security. And it's interesting that Noy knew how to say that even early on in late October. So maybe I will stop here just for the sake of time, and we can pick up the conversation. But I just want to say one thing about the videos. Anat, one of the videos, there was a guitar there, and there is a story on social media about that particular guitar. That's a Palestinian who identified the guitar, who was stolen from his house and played because he knows his neighborhood and he's the only one with that guitar. And those soldiers went into the house. Of course, they took all sorts of personal artifacts and things. And we saw some of the social media images about that. But that particular guitar, so I saw it in
one of the videos. You're talking about one of the videos that I shared. They were using a guitar of a Palestinian. So once again, kind of how, you know, things that were in the past totally illegitimate, right? And people would criticize. And you're right. The point of using homes of Palestinians for Israeli soldiers, like deserted or destroyed homes, now became on the Israeli side, like, totally understandable. They need to stay somewhere. And you could even, I saw a post of someone sharing how they cooked in the kitchen, and he was sharing like what they can they cook and what kind of spices they found and so forth, like the diary of a soldier, right? And nobody now relates, although kind of in the comments people did relate to it, like that was actually in a newspaper, right? In mainstream media, of a soldier reporting, you know, what do we eat? What do we eat during war? And they said, yeah, we stayed in one of these houses. We actually find a lot of spices and so forth. And but when they shared it, nobody thought, like, do you think what it means that you actually are staying in the home of a family and using, you know, you invaded their home and you're using their things as if they were your own, and you're not asking any more questions, but you're actually taking pride of it, right? It's mm-hmm. like that's being taken for granted.
Alrighty, yeah. So this is a good point to stop this exchange for a moment and start addressing some of the questions, some of the comments in the Q&A box. Jeffrey Herf asked, the Times of Israel regularly informs the audience of the situation of Palestinians in Gaza. Is that mainstream? Is it for Israeli consumption? Is it for international consumption? Is the Times of Israel, do you see that as an internal medium or something that is outward looking? Anat.
So yeah, I saw Jeffrey Hurst's question, and he was referring to me. He says the speaker appears not to be aware of Times of Israel, or even more so of Haaretz. She undermines her own credibility by making this broad generalization. So first, I was a reporter for Haaretz, and I'm very much aware of Haaretz and Times of Israel, and they're both, and I assume that Jeffrey reads them in English. And I would say a couple of things. First, I did not, did not say that I relate to all the, you know, shades and many colors. I did say that there are many voices. And of course, Haaretz and Times of Israel are important voices. However, I would say within the Israeli media landscape, definitely Haaretz and both Times of Israel have a very small share of the market. They target a certain audience that is kind of more educated and, of course, liberal and of generally the left wing. And the last thing that I would say is that you probably read these outlets in English, although still with the same political color and journalistic agenda, they are still different in Hebrew. But the most important thing is to understand that most Israelis, like the vast majority, do not read Haaretz. Haaretz has like something like 8% or 10% of the market. It's the best newspaper in Israel, if you ask me. But if I talk about mainstream media, what the vast majority are watching or reading, that would not be Haaretz or Times of Israel. Unfortunately, they're both doing a fantastic job in reporting the war.
All righty, so let's switch gears, and I'm going to ask Mawa. You can keep your camera on, my friend. Can you talk about terminology? There's a question from the audience about the use of certain terms. And the question is as follows. From the beginning, I have noticed common phrase in the American press referring to Hamas militants. To me, this implies that necessarily there are Hamas moderates. How does this rhetorical choice strike you? And if I can expand on that, perhaps, what is the way, how is the terminology, this terminology of terrorists, freedom fighters, militants, combatants, and so on and so forth, how does it play in the Arabic media, if you don't mind addressing that as well? Not only the American, which was the origins of this question, but also the Arab, if you don't mind.
I think it's a significant question how Hamas fighters are described, militants versus like a formal army, armed forces, right? I'm struck by how Netanyahu called, there's a new phrasing he uses now, terrorist army. So it's very interesting. I said on October 7th that somehow before all the repercussions of how we really understood the magnitude of the event. But on October 7th itself, it's as if Hamas, because it was a combined arms kind of orchestrated, designed attack, it was almost as if they graduated terrorism school and enrolled into the armed forces of some sort. That was kind of, it was a rite of passage for them, so that they are doing combined arms, that they are doing that, and then they would be taken as seriously as an army, except that they are not a formal army, armed forces, not a formal state, not a formal anything. So then they can resort to being called, okay, we're a group, we're a militant group, we're an armed group, we're a terrorist group, but you can't hold us accountable as a state with formal armed forces, right? As you would hold another state. So in fact, out of this perplexing dilemma, the call for a Palestinian state actually, maybe even emerging from this necessity, the idea that you might need a Palestinian state next door that has an address with a civilian leadership that would have civilian control over its armed forces so that its armed forces would not launch a war without the strategic design or thinking about it. They're like any other state, like any other state. You don't go to war every day with a neighboring state, even if it's armed to the teeth. Like, look at Egypt and Israel. Both are completely armed, completely strong militaries. They have a treaty. They don't go to war every day. But so I think this vocabulary is very important, whether it's an armed force, which is the army, a militant. But the question about whether it's a Hamas moderate, well, in a sense, who really perceived Hamas as moderates? Lo and behold, it's really Netanyahu, because he thought that if they become the governing apparatus and body and faction within Gaza, as opposed to the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank, he can incrementally annex the West Bank and separate that from Gaza and Hamas. So in a sense, he's the one who trusted, in a sense, that Hamas could govern, and the more money you give it, maybe it will moderate. And this is a theory in political science. All those kind of more extreme right-wing politicians, once they start governing and administering and getting into the public service, so they moderate. Look at the Turkish example, even with the AK Party. Look at other examples. That's a theory. Netanyahu would say today that maybe that theory proven him wrong or whatever because of what happened, because he thought that was. But I think this terminology is important. In the Arab world, Hamas is, could be described sometimes as the resistance, al-muqawma, resistance to the occupation. And that is linking back the West Bank with Gaza. So many people say, well, Israel withdrew from Gaza. Rightly so, 2005. It would be a mini state, but, and that would Netanyahu probably would hope for, like, make it a mini state. This is Palestine. Forget about the West Bank. But then again, lo and behold, apparently there is a connection with the West Bank. So if anyone is resisting the occupation, it's not about the occupation of Gaza, but it's about the occupation of the West Bank. So they would describe some channels, and there is a variety. I mean, you'll find channels variation describing them as a group, or as a resistance group, or as terrorists, or as this, as that. There is a variation of descriptors. But these descriptors matter. I think it's an important question to see how armed forces, armed groups are described.
Thank you so much, Mo. Yeah, we move to the kind of the policy.
Elias, is it okay if I add just 2 points on what?
2 points, said? Absolutely. Go for 2 points.
Okay. First, Netanyahu will never say that he got wrong on anything.
Sorry.
so you're optimistic. In that sense of, like, you know, that the theory proved him wrong, he's never wrong from his own perspective. And the other thing, now more seriously, is I'm not sure if I would say that Netanyahu views Hamas as moderates, or was thinking that they would become more moderate as they take responsibility. I think his view was more, first, we're working with what we have. This is what we have, and we're working with it. And also, which is the main point, it is very important to keep the Palestinians divided, right? We need the extremists in Gaza so we can ignore the moderates on the West Bank, right? Because we all know that the moderate part is the Palestinian Authority, right? So he very well is aware of what Hamas is. But he thought, well, kind of, you know, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. And so I need to nurture the extremists and kind of manage them, right? Control them, keep them restrained. And so, I mean, that was the theory I'm not sure if he really thought, okay, they'll just become like nicer blokes, you know, with power, right?
All right, so we gravitated a bit to the politics. Let's go back to the media side of it. Anat, was there a kind of an Israeli informational strategy put in place this time around? Was there a concerted effort by the state, by the military, to try and kind of shape the narrative coming out with regards to the war, about October 7th, perhaps? There's a question from the audience. Have either Hamas or the Israeli government used any innovative techniques to sell, quote unquote, the narratives in this war?
Uh, if there was a strategy. I would say that first, for sure not. I think everything after the attack, the massacre, was so chaotic. And of course, the media arena is something that is so hard to control, right? And so I think that there wasn't like one strategy. And I think that even now there is, you know, Israel, and I'm sure that the IDF spokesperson does a lot of efforts in, you know, emphasizing the Israeli suffering, the trauma, also emphasizing, you know, how kind of moral and selective are the operations of the Israeli army in Gaza are, and so forth. So they are working in all platforms to convey these messages, right? That we are a moral army, that the soldiers are ethical and selective in kind of, you know, not hurting civilians and so forth. I'm not sure, I'm not seeing like a very clear, well-managed one strategy. And of course, on top of that, we have the political arena where, you know, this government is so extreme and some of its members are so kind of, I don't know how to describe it, but kind of non-representative in some ways. And they're just lashing whatever they have to say, kind of, you know, looking with contempt on Biden or America or the court of the International Court of Justice. And so a lot of arrogance of somebody who's not in a position to be arrogant. So and this is another media aspect, right, which I find very damaging to Israel. And it was part of, you know, the files that were presented to the International Court of Justice, right? Look at what this member of parliament says, and look at what this, you know, and Israel was kind of laughing, you know, don't they understand that these people kind of, nobody listens to them, and we don't, you know, they are not the ones who really make decisions here. You know, we're like in the hood, you know, they don't get it. It's a hood. These were the jokes, right, at that time. So I don't think that there's one thing happening, right?
All righty. Mawa, to you, and again, I'm going to kind of frame it because the question was both Israel and Hamas. I think this was probably one of the first times where you saw GoPro cameras on, you know, showing live feeds from the events of October 7th. Was this intentional? What was the idea? What was the objective there? What is the strategy?
You're saying about Hamas strategy?
Hamas, yes. In terms of October 7th, in terms of their strategy on the ground, October 7th.
There is a media strategy. I think there were, I haven't followed or watched many of the release videos from Hamas personally, but there was like a character I heard about, Ubaidallah. He's the spokesperson of Hamas. And I got feedback from very regular, moderate, regular people saying, yeah, he looks like Superman. There are memes done about him, the way he's dressed. So no, there was a media strategy on Hamas side, but by now it's not even Hamas side, just the Palestinian side. I think their narrative, their symbols, their visuals, this idea of the watermelon, I didn't even understand what that meant, but the watermelon having the colors of the flag, apparently because the flag could be banned. I don't know the origin of that, but because like the green, the red, the blue, the black, so there are watermelons everywhere. So there is even some visualization, some memes, some things like happening that resonate with the larger audience on a humanitarian side. Because as I say, the war now is 5 months and a half later. So there's 2 weeks of ultimate, you know, sympathy and shock. And all of that, it's about the response and whether it's proportionate or not, whether it's collective punishment or not, whether it's functional and smart and strategic, whether it's like targeted or not, or dumb bombs. I mean, so this is what we're having. And it seems to me as if the Israeli audiences are still held within in the media bubble, like you were describing, in a moment that the rest of the world is not necessarily held in, and that makes a disconnect in of itself.
I totally agree with what Marwan is saying, like the split, right? That is actually growing between what the world is seeing, which I think to some extent, again, generally speaking, is also biased, and I'll explain why. And where Israel is, there is more kind of looking inside and feeling this isolation. The world is against us and people cannot understand us and we have the right to defend ourselves. All these arguments, which I, to some extent, I can totally understand. And I would say that there is an inherent bias in news reporting. October 7th is one day. News are reported by the minute, by the hour, by the day, right? So in terms of news, October 7th is 5 months ago. This is history. This, you know, in one, where was it? The Guardian, I think, they talked about the massacre that happened last year. That was in January, right? The massacre happened 2 months ago. And I thought, you know, that's so cynical and biased. You're talking about last year. You know, there are people who are still hostages and there are some people who were not even found, right? How can you say that, right? But it's just, and I think that was intentional. Say, forget about it, you know? But there's an inherent issue here of, we've reported on October 7th. It happened, lasted, say, 2 days, ended. We're in a different story now of this war, and the war is happening day by day for 5 months. So you can understand why the world, as it follows it from a distance, is thinking, oh wow, this is forever and it doesn't end, and you know, which is also understandable. And the massacre, well, why are you still there? Well, Israelis are very much there, you know, because the trauma is something that only Israelis can really, really feel, maybe Jews around the world, because they are also affected by it in so many ways, right? But if you're not part of it, can you really feel as those who were targeted feel, right?
I think that both, you know, Anat showed a couple of clips or a couple of reels from social media. Can we talk about social media and the coverage of conflicts now? Does it make it more difficult? What about the professionalism? Somebody asked, what about the misinformation or the disinformation, both on social media as well as professional reporting? You know, news that is so immediate, is there a way to cross your sources, to verify, to double check, triple check, and only then come out with a headline, so to speak? Mawa, go ahead first, my friend.
Well, a couple of things to be said about that. So misinformation, disinformation, all of that. Well, for example, I remember one example of the spokesperson, the Israeli spokesperson, Ofer Gendelman. When he shares a video that turns out to be very fake of some supposedly a Palestinian who's saying, don't listen to Hamas, pronouncing it this way, which it's not the way the Palestinians will say. It will say Hamas, not Hamas. And go away or leave your houses. And it turns out to be like some actress, like some Israeli actress saying that. And like a formal account would reshare something like that and then have to withdraw it. And people say, this is obviously fake video. Some mistakes like that is done by a spokesperson on this side or on that side, then you start losing they lose the credibility once they engage improperly with the social media, like they want to retweet or share. And if they don't verify from their end, that takes away from the authority they hold as a position of spokesperson. So I saw incidents of that. In terms of verifying double and triple, I think there were many stories. I mean, volumes will be written in terms of like journalistic analysis of this. For example, Al Ahli Hospital or the attack on that and how it was covered and, you know, being attributed to Israel and then saying, no, well, there were other rockets from the other side. Rushing to report it one way. But then the narrative stays. So people will say, okay, let's say it wasn't even Israel, but what about the other hospitals anyway? You know, so it's kind of like there, you will always be subjected to these things. And unless you're like avid follower of what happened, when that does chip from the credibility of the source you watch. So let's say you watch CNN or Al Jazeera or BBC or whatever. And when they make these mistakes, definitely it holds in your mind, ah, those are the ones who said that and it was wrong. But then you still resort to them. And it's interesting that you start resharing when they get to try it according to your own viewpoint. So now you say, oh, but yeah, it's said on CNN. Even if you discounted CNN yesterday, you kind of like say, hey, CNN said it in order to make an argument for someone who believes in CNN coverage, let's say, or get it from Al Jazeera in order to convince someone on the other side. Hey, they're even saying that. So it's interesting how we consume these traditional media and then how we appropriate them to the social media and how we converse in them. I think in the end, it's important that we as people like coming now conversing in a civil way of engaging with the content of what we're watching, what we're witnessing as eyewitnesses on history, beyond the mediated aspect of things. So in the end, we still have to have our conversations, I would say.
Can I relate?
Please go ahead. You have a minute.
I'm asked a lot about, you know, misinformation and disinformation. I would say misinformation, disinformation is the problem. One of the examples is all the information about sexual violence, sexual crimes that were made by Hamas terrorists that were denied and still are denied by some. And then information came out, and investigative work by the New York Times and the report by the UN that just came out. And I think it's immensely important because women were raped, mutilated, murdered, and we don't know what's happening with the hostages, with the female hostages in Gaza right now. But we are very, very, very well know with evidence that crimes against women, sexual crimes, were happening during the massacre. However, most of the problem is not so much about the facts, but the bias that you have in the information, the framing, right? As the example that I gave of the massacre of last year, right? Or moderate Hamas or something like that, framing, you know, this reality that is complicated, confusing, hard to digest, you know, in the way that the audience wants to hear it to justify their previous point of view, right? So we want to hear the things that we want to hear. We want to read the reality in the way we want to read it to confirm our beliefs and attitudes. I have one advice, which I keep telling my students and in every lecture, pay for your media. Pay for your media. Go to media outlets that are behind payment wall that you need to subscribe, that have the reputation of doing good journalism, not because they're lacking any problems, but because this is the best guarantee of kind of rule of thumb of getting something that is better, of more quality. And I'm talking about the New York Times, be it, or in Israel would be Haaretz, or the Wall Street Journal, or and so forth. It guarantees that the work that the journalists do is really intended to serve you. So you're still not going to live in a perfect world, right? And you can still talk about biases and problems and so forth, right? But I think it's kind of a good criteria of assuring that the quality of information and analysis you'll get through subscription rather than advertising-based media would be better.
Alrighty, I think this is a good point to stop the conversation. I think we had a significant amount of information to digest. There's a lot of perspectives here, very nuanced and very interesting. And we can certainly think about different ways we can take advantage of some of the insights and some of the recommendations that you both shared with us. I'd like to thank you for attending, for sharing your thoughts, sharing your analysis of the events. And hopefully,
Eli, can I say one last thing?
Oh yes, please.
That I do hope, and I hope everyone here shares with me this thought, that the hostages will return to Israel soon, and you know, there will be a deal, ceasefire.
I actually think that will happen, surprisingly.
Yeah.
All right. So I hope we can end with this wish for some peace and quiet, some optimism, and some good news from the region. Thank you so much for those who joined us.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Have a wonderful evening. Take care.
Bye.